We'd like to thank everyone for coming out this day in a celebration. So this is to Emma Wiggins and to the bereaved family, her sons and her daughters. We give our condolence to you and to the minister of the Figueroa Church of Christ and to the Figueroa family. I will be your master ceremony for the day. We ask you to silence your phones. Put it on vibrate as we not interrupt the service. At this time, we're going to have Brother Al Garrett to come and lead us in congregational song. Then I'll come back and do word of prayer.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansion bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us the place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, oh, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. When we all get to heaven, oh, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Oh, when we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory.
In that good morning, we will shout the victory. At this time, let us have a word of prayer. Our eternal Father, which art in heaven, how holy and awesome is your name. We approach your throne of grace and mercy at this time with thanksgiving, thanking you, Father, for your love and for your patience and your long-suffering with us as your servants. And Father, we come at this occasion of a celebration of a life that lived, that one of your saints, that Father, went off the scene. And Father, we ask you to give this family comfort at this time, that, Father, they may demonstrate the character of love for one another. And, Father, as our Lord Jesus came in to walk among mankind and to show love. And, Father, we ask for the Holy Spirit to help us this day, to comfort us and help us how to go forward in this program. We pray for the man of God as he comes shortly to proclaim you and grab the word, that he may say those things that stir our minds up, that give us the faith that we need to hold on to your unchanging hand. Forgive us of any sin we have committed, word, thought, or deed, as we petition our prayer unto you at this time. And all these blessings do ask in Jesus' name. Amen. The scripture will be coming from Psalms 23. Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anointed my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'd like you to repeat these words after me, if you will. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. New Testament passage scripture is coming from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning at verse number 13. Let's see. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who are falling asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the words of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with the shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And those who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And then we shall ever, will always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Amen. At this time, we're going to ask Al to come back and to lead us in another selection. thank you. At this time, we're going to have special remarks by Dr. Broadway. Also, we'll have the obituary read by Sister Savant. And then after that, I will come back for the other presentation.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the family of Emma Williams, thank you. Thank you for your prayers, your words of comfort, your cards, your visits, your flowers, and any other acts of kindness expressed during her period of illness and at the time of our great loss. We are thankful for the many blessings and the memories that you shared with her. At this time, I would like to share expressions of love from the family members. However, before I start, I would like to introduce Glenn Glass, who will share his thoughts.
Hey, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Thank you so much for coming out, and she would have loved this, and we have a lot of relationships with everybody, and it's just hard and devastating right now for me. But I always said, at the end, the jig is up. I don't want to take a lot of time, but you guys know the story. We were able to go by the 3rd Avenue house, 41st house, 78th. And I didn't go to Compton yet. So it's just like back in Jeremiah where it said that, you know, I knew you before you were in your mother's womb. If I go back from April 4th and count back 9 months, that'll take me back to July of 1939. Somewhere in the middle of July 1939, that's when the egg and the sperm came together. From the egg and the sperm coming together, but we know that he knew us before we was in our mother's womb. So we know that there was a relationship there, and not just with her, with all of us. And probably looking at most of this room other than Rose, all of us in 1939 were in that same space. We were all in that same space at that same time. So, absent from the body, back with the Lord, I look at all of them, Uncle Charles, Granddaddy, and all of them, the whole group, back together again. Everybody's back where they came from. And this is what's going to happen to all of us. And I just look at the whole thing and recognize it and thankful for the 80 years. The story played out the way it has played out. It didn't play out that she was gone in the 50s or 60s or anything like that. What, I'll be 60 in January, so let's say almost 60 years and have your mother with you. And that's, well, you know, in the up until really recently, Mama didn't have a lot of health issues and stuff, you know. Growing up, she was able to go and do what she needed to do, where she wanted to go. I've never really known her to want for anything, you know. But that's just where we are. I bring y'all greetings from the Greenville Avenue Church of Christ, and they have really, really, really been behind me and my family. The things I do for the church, I'm not an elder or a deacon, but you wouldn't know it by the work that's done, and that comes from, you know, Granddaddy and growing up. And I was just telling my wife, I hadn't been in this building since Merle Johnson passed, and that was in 73. But I remember Granddaddy and Mom and all of us coming in here to view Merle, and I know all of his relatives there in East Texas. I'm in Dallas, Texas, so I've just had a wonderful life being in Dallas. I'm having the relationship of the Figueroa Church of Christ, because most of y'all, a lot of y'all have relatives in East Texas. And if I ran out of gas on Highway 20 and somebody knew that I was in the Church of Christ from Figueroa, they come running. You They have come running, and that's why it's been so peaceful and enjoyable being there for really since 1980 going to Southwest. But Mama's done all she could do, and I'm glad, again, the story's played out, that she knew all of us, knew all the grandkids, knew y'all, knew stories, and up even to the end. I think I talked to her that Sunday about 2:30 Dallas time, and she was had a raspy voice. But I knew that it was coming close. And I said, man, June's going to be it. I just know it. I didn't think it would be June 1st. But that's just the way it went. So, again, I don't want to take any more time from anybody, but we just all keep on keeping on. I hope I haven't stumbled over my words, that you guys really understand where I'm coming from. And, again, it's going to be more families daily that's going through this. In March, I lost probably four. My business partner, Sister Cole, Charles Johnson, and Terrell, and Mama. That's just the way it goes. That's the way it goes and the way it is. So, again, I'm thankful for all of you guys to take the chance on coming out, not knowing if the seating, this COVID thing, and all of that, just to you know, to be with us. We go back from almost day one of my life, Pat and Stewart family and everything. But I have tried to live up to the church responsibilities at Greenville, and they're still calling and wanting to come out here and be just whatever I need. That Church of Christ with Brother Gibbs and the elders, I can't ask me anymore. I told them to stop calling me yesterday when we were at the restaurant for dinner. But they just want to make sure that whatever I need, they have been through for us. And I don't even ask them for nothing. And I went to my box. I'm over transportation. I'm the Brother Lanier of Greenville Avenue. I am the Brother Lanier with the transportation department. And I looked in my box. I was just going through the mail and the insurance and things like that to make sure they would be all right while I'm gone. And there was a check in there for us. I said, what is this? Oh, Glass, we know you're going to California, and we know this, know this. And I opened that check up. I said, dang. This is unbelievable. Wenzel, we want to thank you so much for the journey and the respect and the honor and the this and the that and everything, man, that you've done. And it's just unbelievable to me that it went the way it has. And this man here, shoot. He honored and respected and made sure Mama had it. That's why being in Dallas, I really wasn't just worried about things. People would say, Glenn, you need to come out. And I know I would even be coming out for just to say goodbye or coming out to this funeral. But I knew she was with him, that he covered every day. Thing and some that men don't do. And probably, I'm telling you, you got to go through 1,000 to find half of one. So, again, just being the oldest one, I don't say thank you, man. Thank you. And you need anything, you pick up. Somebody pick up the phone and don't even look at the time. Just call me. I take calls 2 in the morning, but it doesn't matter. So, again, we go from there. And, Sherry, you've done outstanding with everybody.
Thank you, Glenn. Expressions from the grandchildren. My Nana, you have been my number one supporter since July 24, 1985. Thank you for sharing with me your sense of adventure, love of fashion, love of cooking, love of the Lord and His church. I am so thankful that God allowed you to be a part of every graduation and to see my dream fulfilled of becoming Dr. Glass. Thank you for showing us how to be faithful to God through trials and sickness and until death. I'm going to miss you, our phone calls, and laughing together. I'm so grateful for 34 years of memories and laughter with you. I love you. Love, your girl, Amanda. Dear grandmother, it makes me sad to know that I will not see you again. I'm happy that you were able to come to my high school graduation and celebration. I really enjoyed spending time with you last year on our cruise and going to Searcy, Arkansas to hear Nicholas speak. I'm glad we had a chance to spend a lot of time together last summer. I will miss coming to California every spring and summer to see you. I hate that I have to say goodbye right now. I love you, and I know that you love me too. I know you're shining down on me. Love, Justin. Grandma, time and time again, I've turned to you to feel the warmth of your caring presence and your love. Thank you for being such a constant light in my life. You mean so much to me in so many, many ways. Love you, miss you, Austin. When I look at you, I see someone with a grateful heart. You brought out the best in everyone, surrounding those you cared about with a gentle and patient kind of love. When I look at you, I see someone I admire deeply, who's the heart of our family and the wonderful woman I am proud to call Grandma. How fortunate I've felt over the years to have a grandma I've grown to know so well and have learned from all along the way. How fortunate I will always feel to carry around the rich stories, the lessons, and the laughter you have shared. You have touched my life in ways that are big and small. What a wonderful gift from a very wonderful woman. Love always, Nick. A great grandmother's love. Her smile was quick to welcome you. Her arms always open wide. Her hugs a happy place because there was always love inside. It meant so much to have a great grandma like you. I love you and will miss you. Melanie, your great granddaughter. Mom, no matter what I do today or where the future takes me tomorrow, I promise to remember all the things you've taught me and how very much you love me. And in case I didn't always say it, and sometimes I forgot to show it, I want you always to know that I love you. I thank you, Mom, for being someone I've always been able to turn to for acceptance, reassurance, and love. You taught me values that will last my lifetime. Thank you, Mom, for filling my life with so much love. No matter where I am, you will always be a part of me in thought, in my heart, and more importantly, in love. Love, Garvin. When a mother says, I love you, she also means I'll do anything for you. When she wishes you good night, she's saying, your dreams are my dreams too. And when she calls out, see you soon, she's promising I'll be with you wherever you go. Thank you, Mom, for always being there. Thank you for the many ways you've shown your love to me. I'm grateful for every single one. Love you always and forever, your daughter, Sherry. In closing, I leave you with this. Our lives will go on without you, but nothing will be the same. We will have to hide our heartache when someone speaks your name. Sad are our hearts that love you deeply and dearly. Silent are our tears that will fall. Living without you is going to be the hardest part of all, because you did so many things for us. Your heart was always so kind and so true. And when we needed someone, we knew that we could always count on you. There will be no more special times and events that we will share together. However, with the love in our hearts, you will walk with us forever. Love, your family. Today, you received an abbreviated funeral program. An official program is in the process of being prepared and will be sent to each of you and others via U.S. mail at a later date. Again, we thank you for your presence here today and appreciate you for everything you've done. Thank you. obituary. On April 4th, 1940, in Hickory Flat, Mississippi, the fifth of six children, Emma Williams, was born to the late Mr. and Mrs. Puppet Figueroa. She sang in the chorus, worked with the Benevolence Ministry, and supported the Little Angels Chorus, where her children sang and participated well into their teens. Emma was one to give of her means when she saw a good cause and wanted to make certain that that person or event would be successful. In 1960, she married Grady Glass, and to this union, three children were born: Glenn, Garvin, and Sherry. As a devoted mother, she always supported and cheered her children on by attending their singing and piano recitals, wrestling matches, and volleyball games, as well as drill team practices and competitions. Later in life, she was wedded to the late Denny Williams of Compton, California. Emma had an adventurous spirit, and she loved to travel. Her adventures took her throughout the Caribbean, Mexico, and even Alaska. She was an amazing baker and enjoyed baking cakes, pies, and a variety of cookies. She was very particular about the aesthetics of the pastry she baked, and in addition to baking, Emma enjoyed helping her daughter Sherry with her catering business. When there was an event that she helped with, she would make certain that the fine details were there to make the food look like a picture. The one thing we knew for certain, she loved shopping. Shopping was her pastime. She would say, "You should always look your best." That statement was evident in the hat she wore Sunday after Sunday and the way she would dress her children. I just have to stop and note that Sherry has several of her mother's lovely hats on display. So you can see she certainly meant you need to look your best. Emma loved being a grandmother to her four grandchildren: Amanda, Justin, Austin, and Nicholas, and one great-granddaughter, Malani. She would shop and buy the best dresses and suits for her grandchildren to look their best, attend all birthday parties, football games, baseball games, church activities, graduations, and teach them about serving God and working in the church. She sent presents, Christmas presents, and never forgot a birthday. That's a good grandma. Emma truly loved family. And in July of 2019, she was able to have all of her children and grandchildren together in Searcy, Arkansas. Throughout her life, Emma loved to take pictures of her travels, experiences, family, and self before selfies were in style. She was preceded in death by her parents, siblings, Ida Harris, Charles Hodges, William Hodges, James Lee Hodges, and Ruby Mark. She leaves to cherish her memories three children: Glenn Glass and Jeanette of Dallas, Texas; Garvin L. Glass of Mississippi; Sherry Brown and Daryl of Los Angeles, California. Four grandchildren: Dr. Amanda Glass, D.C., of Dallas, Texas; Justin L. Glass of Nashville, Tennessee; Austin Brown and Nicholas Brown of Los Angeles, California;
and one great-granddaughter, Melani Brown of Los Angeles, California. In addition to a host of family, friends, and church members, the family would like to give a special thanks to Emma's special friend, Mr. Wetzel S. Scott, for his love and care. That this family is what we call some of our aristocracy of Figueroa. The Hodges were always there, always involved, and so we know that Sherry Glenn Garvin will keep this going, as you've been taught well. I have two resolutions, if you can bear with me. The first one is from the Greenville Avenue Church of Christ, and it is a resolution of respect for Emma Williams. Honor her for all that her hands have done, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate. Proverbs 31 and 31. To the family, our hearts grieve, and we share in the loss of your loved one and our dear sister in Christ, Emma Williams. We, the members of the Greenville Avenue Church of Christ, extend our deepest sympathy to you today. You are in the hearts and thoughts of your Greenville Avenue Church family in Richardson, Texas. May our prayers and words of comfort help you and your family through this time of sorrow, remembering that God will sustain you through it all and in days ahead. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth, 3 John 1 through 4. And his mother treasured up all these things in her heart, Luke 2:51. To our dearest brother, Glenn Glass, it is so important that you know how special you are to the church leadership and to the entire congregation at Greenville Avenue Church of Christ. Your love for the congregation and the ministries that you so lovingly and unselfishly serve in demonstrates a kind of spirit embodied within a godly mother, teaching and instilling in her children the same as described in the scripture. Your childhood lessons tend to stick with you, and throughout mother's loving spirit alive and well within you. We, as a congregation, recognize and appreciate your services, your willingness, and the kind of nature in which you serve with the highest respect. We too honor and thank God for the wisdom, the teachings, and the beautiful life lived before you by your precious mother. It is our gain to have you as a member and an honor to have you as our dear brother. You are not alone. We too are sorrowful. The loss of your mother has touched our hearts, and we grieve with you. We, your spiritual family, are here to comfort you in your endeavors and to find peace and strength. We are here to do everything we can to help you through this. We love you, and we want you to know that God is with you. May the precious memories of your mother remain in your heart. And may the Lord continue to watch over you and your families. Whereas the passing of Sister Emma Williams has touched the hearts of the Greenville Avenue congregation, We acknowledge that she shared a spiritual bond and a very special love for her children and loved ones. Her kind spirit and compassion for others will continue to represent and shine through the lives she touched and her family members as we know them. Therefore, be it resolved that we, the members of the Greenville Avenue Church of Christ, encourage the family to find comfort in the Holy Scriptures, keeping their trust and faith in God. We are here to assist you. We are here to assist the family of Sister Emma Williams, and we'll continue to express our love for the Glass family in the days ahead. Excuse me. Humbly submitted, your Greenville Avenue Church family, Elders Deacon Shelton III, Minister. Resolution in the memory of Emma Hodges Glass Williams. Whereas Emma was a longtime member of the Figueroa Church of Christ, along with her parents, the late Elder Hodges and Mother Ethel Hodges, were dedicated and faithful members and workers at the Figueroa Church of Christ. And whereas Emma and her siblings grew up at the Figueroa Church of Christ, Emma was faithful in attendance and a supporter of Christian education, and assisted with the youth chorus, the Little Angels. Emma possessed a quiet, humble spirit. Therefore, God is in control and never makes a mistake. To our dear member Sherry Brown and brothers Garvin and Glenn Glass and other family members, she has finished her course. She has kept faith. We, your church family, mourn your loss. Take care of each other, love each other, and thank God for the family you are blessed with. Resolve that the family and the members accept the decision of a wise God. Family and friend, treasure your memories of Emma in your hearts. Further resolved, a copy of this resolution will be presented to the family and a copy placed in the Figueroa Church of Christ this 12th day of June, 2020. She has done what she could. Submitted by Vincent Hawkins, James Maxwell Ministers, Reuben Boykin Sr., Jerome Thompson Sr., and Forrest Whitaker Jr., Elders.
Thank you for those resolution presentation. At this time, we're going to have a pictorial presentation. At this time, Garvin.
Thank you, brother. And again, on behalf of family and some of the things that my brother has said, I do share those with you as well. You know, as a child, one grows up thinking, when they think of superheroes, they think of someone who's made of steel, who can jump tall buildings, who could run as fast as animals and things like that. But you know, for me, it was a technician, a labor worker, a unionized 410 person that by the age of 24 had three children. At 24, I was writing software and at McDonnell Douglas building aircraft. Not a worry in the world. Could go out, stay out long as I wanted to. I was a king of my own world. But for her, three kids, three, two, one infant, she made a lot of sacrifices. great deal of sacrifices. And if you can imagine yourself at that age with those responsibilities, and then having to go back to your parents who were God-fearing, and having them taking you back, taking all four of us back in, and knowing, especially for the boys, that she wanted a positive role, male role model influence for them. So she pushed us to do activities in the church. Glenn went into singing. I wanted to understand about the church business, so my grandfather took me under his wing and started telling me and showing me how the church was ran. And when I think about those sacrifices, of some of the things that she was doing just to place her kids first, and I think about as I was growing in knowledge and asking questions, she got to a point that she couldn't answer some of the questions. And I remember the day that a salesman came in and sold him a encyclopedia, a library. And she was asking me, how did I like it? And my head was just down turning the pages. And I was just so into that. And when I think back at that, now being a manager myself, it took her about 2 months of overtime to pay for that. Sacrifices. Trying to make those things and give us, and I'll keep it 100. Glenn and Sherry didn't read those books as much as I did, but they enjoyed it. But at the same time, she saw a need to wanting to give aid like any parent to make sure that the things that were set in front of me allowed me to continue to thirst and continue wanting to do more. She was very an advocate to make sure we went to the church choir rehearsals, to be around other Christian kids. She said, if you're around other Christian kids, and I know the families, I know they're going to take care of you because I know they're not going to let you do anything that I wouldn't want to do. And you best believe if they come back and tell me, it's going to be something else. I tried it once, and she proved it to me. But when I think about those costs and I think about the things, even as I start going in my career, started going globally. It was okay. She didn't care where I went. No, she had a phone call. She said, I got to be able to reach you. I ended up having to design a network that I had a local California number that would reach me in China just so she could ask me, what are you doing today? How did it go today? Are you going out for Chinese? We would go out and laugh about it. I said, Mom, they just say go out to dinner because everything is Chinese here. And she would laugh, and she would ask me certain things, and then she would ask me about, well, what's Mexico like? And I would tell her, what's Canada like? And I would tell her. And then it would get to the point that we just had that relationship that even in my recent job, I didn't know this, but in the South, there's only one person that could interrupt a director's meeting or a manager's meeting, and that's somebody's mom. And so you could always tell when the executive had a call from mom, it was, oh, yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am. and I started laughing. And so my mother, our mother, I should say, when she called, she would always say, Garvin, this is your mother. And I would laugh, and I said, "You don't think I recognize your voice?" She said, "I just want to announce who's calling you at this time." So then I would answer it and get to the point of talking to her. And I'm going to miss those calls. I'm going to miss the fact that I would, at the end of the day, as I was driving back, I would always call her. She knew, okay, you exiting the plant now. I said, "Yep." She said, "How was your day?" I said, "Well, it was like this." You didn't get in trouble, did you? I said, no. I didn't fire nobody today. And so she would laugh, and she would just talk to me about those things. And then as my son got used to video conferencing her, she would get thrilled just to hear him and see him. And I'm sorry that Justin, who's looking online, I'm sorry that he couldn't be here. But due to the COVID, I just felt as a parent that I couldn't provide a safe passage for him to get here in time for that. So he came up with ways in which he would call her. I would video call, conference call her. So I was able to see her every day. And then seeing those things and seeing her talk, she would talk about everything in the world, about what I'm doing, next steps. But she always wanted me to talk to her doctors. I said, Garvin, I never want the doctor to tell me. I want you to tell me. So then doctors were calling me, and I remember getting that one phone call from my sister. I was in the middle of production, and I said, what is it, Sherry? Sherry said, Garvin, you have to call the doctor. Call him today. So then I was walking back and walking back to my office one day, and I called the doctor, and he began to tell me things about the chemo and what things were working and what things weren't working. And then I stopped, and I said, well, okay, come up with another solution. He said, well, you don't understand. I don't have any more solutions. I said, no, you don't understand. Go find a solution. And so we went back and forth. So finally, I called my mother. And that was probably one of the most painful conversations I ever had. Someone who has been trained to problem solve couldn't fix that problem. And then she looked at me and she said, it's going to be all right. I said, well, you're coaching me. And so I said, why did you say that? She said, well, I knew if you talked to him, you probably asked him 5,000 questions. You probably threatened to fire him 3,000 times, and you were going to come up with some type of answer. But then when I told her the alternatives, I said, I didn't know if you're strong enough to go through this second route. And she said, okay. And I remember she just looked at me. And I looked back at her and said, yes, I think it'll be all right. And then at that point, she asked me to call Justin. And we conference called him in. And from that point, I was never the same. And so I was planning on coming out some time ago, and then we were starting back up production and then from the COVID. And I remember getting a phone call from Cedric Payne, one of the brothers. And I was kind of curious because the fact that he never called me that early. And so when I contacted him back, I was, what was going on? I thought he was referring to me going back to work. And he was trying to tell me about Mom. And so we were on two different pages. He was sympathizing, I was sympathizing, saying, yeah, it's rough to get back at work. And he was saying, no, God, I don't think we're on the same page. And then when he said Mom passed, I just, Vincent, I must have tried to fire about 50 people that time. Because at that point, I didn't want to hear an excuse from people after hearing all of the things that was going on. But like Glenn has said, and like Sherry has said, you know, it's a blessing to have a parent for 80 to live to be 80 years old. And before I leave, I want to give a special announcement from Elder and Sister Justin Minor from Nashville. The Minor family and Hodges family probably known each other for about 65 years. And he wanted to give his thanks and prayers for knowing. And lastly, for Robert Norris of Atlanta. He said Mom was so inspiring and supporting during the earlier developments as he was trying to put the angelic course together. She was one of those parents that always stood behind him to give him things and encourage him, and he wanted to acknowledge to the family of his support for that as well. Again, for the grandkids, one of the last things Mom said was that she wanted and emphasized for you to finish school, go to college, get your career started. And I made a promise to her that Austin, Nicholas, that I would do everything I could to make sure that you had those avenues available to you. And I just want to make sure that those are things that she wanted, because she looked at it from a technician labor perspective and said she wanted her seed to be better than what she had. And from there, I look and I manage hundreds of moms now. So I say it's to you, you can do those things and put your things, put God first, and the family's going to be behind you. I can't tell you how ecstatic she was, Amanda, when she found out you were the first doctor of the family. Now the door is open for Nicholas and Austin to finish that up and tie that up. Get your career started. Don't waste time, because time is valuable. Thank you.
At this time, we have the presentation of the pictorial and the life of Sister Emma Williams at this time.
Comes from you. Text that I'm going to share in just a moment, I can see the resiliency in you as well. I can see your mother. And now I know why you wear the hats. I kept trying to figure it out, but the women at Figueroa wear hats, you know, and so I guess I have to go shopping and buy Kathleen a hat or two. It's good to be with church family. These are difficult times. We are challenged on so many fronts. We're losing our loved ones even in the midst of this COVID-19 virus, along with some of the social issues that are taking place. And then we have to gather on a regular to say goodbye to those we love. Our enemy, death, has come and claimed another soul. But in reality, God called her home because it was her time. You know, 80 years is a long time. Psalms division 90, the scriptures teach that we are given 70 years. That's 70. And if by reason of strength, 80 years, that's a long time. 80 years and a family, a single mother, and then, of course, having embraced her grandchildren and great-grand, that's worthy, that's noteworthy. And then to have her daughter and sons take care of her, that's a beautiful thing. In Mark, the 14th chapter, there is an account of Jesus as he is preparing for his last days on earth. He was in Bethany in the house of one Simon the leper. A woman approached him with a costly bottle of perfume, which she opened and poured on her head, on his head rather, in preparation for his burial. Of course, the onlookers there were furious and complained. They criticized the woman because they felt that the perfume should have been sold and the money given to the poor. And we know now that was not the case. But Jesus came to her defense. And he said three things about her that I think can be said about you guys' mom. The first thing Jesus said in John 14, verse 6, is that she has done a good work for me. The fact that she would give her life savings and open up a bottle of perfume and anoint the Messiah speaks volumes about her heart. And when I listen to the story of your mother coming from Mississippi to California, working, making sure the family was taken care of, that's noteworthy. And I appreciate the narrative because you have, number one, a legacy of work ethic left behind for you to follow. But even greater still, Jesus moved on and said, not only has she done a good work for me, but number two, she has done what she could. And when you come up in that area, you have limited resources. And you have to make a way out of no way, but I know it was God that sustained that family and gave them what they needed when they needed it. And so take a sense of resolve in the fact that your mom did what she could. And then the last thing Jesus said about this woman is that what she has done will be told in a memorial. And it's no accident that here we are several thousand years later referencing the same woman today because of what she did. Her life was a memorial. And so to the family, I want to say to you, you are your mother's memorial. So live up to, number one, her faith. Put your trust in God. And it's a beautiful thing to see Glenn faithful and Garvin faithful. And Sherry can't help but be faithful. She's one of the mothers, and she don't even know it at the church. And every church has a number of mothers. You know, they're the ones that make stuff go. And then, of course, you learn that there are certain people, certain mothers, who know how to get things done. And Sherry's one of them. Sherry does top-notch stuff. When she does luncheons and dinners and stuff, she goes way out. She wanted to do a breakfast for the preacher and read me the menu. I says, we will postpone that. But I appreciate that. Now I know where you got it from. Work ethic, integrity, honesty, love, care, and above all, faith. And so we are grateful to be a part of this celebration. I know your hearts are broken. And it's difficult sometimes to reconcile our grief to gladness and gratitude and our sadness to this business of celebration, but because she died in the Lord. And if there is a notable accomplishment out of all that she had done, that's the greatest accomplishment. She died in the Lord. And we are mindful of Revelation chapter 14 and verse 13. John the Revelator declared that he heard a voice from heaven. And that voice said to him, write, blessed are the dead that die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labor, and their works do follow, and you are those works. God bless you. If anything I can do to help you during this difficult time, I'm available. We love you. And the Figueroa family loves you as well. God bless.
As we get ready to close our service here, we ask everybody to be timely that we can get to the cemetery. We want to thank Glenn, Garvin, and Sherry for this opportunity, allowing me to come and be a part of the family. I go back with this family for over 30 years at Figueroa. I'm that lost child that you haven't seen, but I was at Figueroa many years ago. And I worked at Figueroa with Brother Hodges doing the Zone meeting and the other elders there at Figueroa. We just thank God for being there. Let us pray at this time. Eternal wise Father in heaven, we thank you for your word that has been delivered this day. We ask you, Father, that we come with the celebration of life of Sister Emma Williams, that we never forget her labor of love that she has demonstrated for the congregation throughout this city and throughout this world. We ask you to bless this family now and give them the comfort that they need to hold unto your unchanging hand. And all these bless me do ask in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we'll turn it over to Harrison Ross, mortuary.